chapter 5. Verse 13 and 14. And you will find these words. Ye are the salt of the earth. But if the salt have lost its savor, wherewith it shall be salted, it is thenceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out and to be trodden under the foot of man. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading, to the hearing, and to our understanding of his word. You may be seated.
Yeah. critical. It was spoken and heard it in my spirit, and I want to share it with you. And the reason I'm taking there is because as we move forward in life, we're going to run into people who are going through things. We're going to run into people who are witnessing their walk, who have done some things and they feel that they are far, far away from God, that God will not forgive them or God can overlook some of the things that they've done. And the reason they feel that way is because there's some people who won't forgive them for what they've done. But we've got to help them understand and see that God is not like us. God is so far from us that we need to be able to assure them that no matter where they are in life, no matter what they are going through or have been going through, that God has got that down. Look at the 20th verse in Romans, the 5th chapter. And I'm going to read the whole thing, but it's the second part of that sentence, that verse that I want us to focus on. For just a few moments, it says, moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound. That means there are rules and regulations. And God wanted us to know about the rules and regulations. And when you break a rule or a regulation or a behavior pattern, we know that we have violated God's statutes. And we can get to a point where we think that we have done so much that God could not possibly forgive us, that God could not possibly overlook what we've done or what has happened. But look at the last part of the verse where it says here, but where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. Let me break that down for you. What it's saying is God has more grace than you have sin. That means you can never out-sin God's grace. Y'all hear what I'm saying? And that's key to such, because once again, I'm sharing with you, there will be people who think based on, once again, what they hear from some of us, that God could not possibly ever forgive them for whatever that thing is that they've done. Amen. They may not even share it with you. You might not even share it with somebody else. But I want you to see right here that sin, it abounds. But look what it said. What does that part say? Now, I thought at least one person in here would get happy on that one. I thought at least one person would celebrate on that one. That no matter what level of sinner you may be the vilest, the foulest, the rudest, the crudest, you can be the worst of the worst. And have done things that you are embarrassed and ashamed to even remember. But I want you to know right here, and I want you to see this, and I want you to note that. So whenever you witness or share with somebody, let them know that grace abounds much more than their sin, so you can't out-sin God's grace. Amen. I just thought I'd drop that in your sin. I just thought that I would celebrate that with these one person. Because I know I've done some stuff. Sometimes I wonder about my stuff, but God has covered my stuff. Amen, God's covered all my stuff. And he's released me from it. That's worth celebrating. That's worth shouting about. Now, that's worth dancing about. Hey, glory to God.
So what does that mean?
Say it.
We look at ourselves, our spiritual self, what? Compared to God's word, not anyone else. We do this introspection to see who we really are. Not who we faking, but who we really are. All right? That's shit. What is swag? Ask your neighbor, do you have your swag? Do you have swag? Do you have spiritual weapons that are anointed by God? Because without your swag, you sad. You have to have those spiritual weapons because the battle is not in the natural realm. All right, so there's swag and then there's flow. Ask your neighbor, are you flowing? Are you flowing? What's flow?
Full light of the word.
So when I'm flowing, I'm the full light of God's word, then what happens? We can operate in the heavy fog. Ask your neighbor, are you operating in the heavy fog? And they looking at you and ask what that is? Tell me, favor of God. Tell your neighbor, I operate in heavy fog all the time. With the swag, with the shift, flow, years ago. I can walk. See, that means sometimes people get upset when folk walk with a bit of confidence. We have already too cocky. No, sometimes when you know what you know, it isn't when you know what you know, and you know that you know that you know. Can't no one tell you that you don't know what you know when you know that what you know. And that means that there's no weapon form that can prosper against me. That means no matter how much you talk about me, God's going to shut you down. So I can walk into a situation knowing that it's overcome. Even when I come to the front door. See, most of us, if we see it coming, we run the other way. But what you can't understand is this. It only comes to your front door because God knows he's going to prepare you and equip you so that you can overcome by going through it so it will never scare you again.
Amen. All right.
Amen. See? All right. This must be, this is the Friday night crowd. It don't seem like it's Sunday morning up in here. All right. So, let's look at the fifth chapter, 1 and verse 13 and 14. We'll finish this up because it didn't finish up last week. It says, you are the salt of the earth, but the salt has lost its savor. Wherewith shall be salted, it is therefore good for nothing but to be cast out and to be trodden under the foot of men. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. And we dealt with the salt part, so today we're going to finish up on the light part. Ask your neighbor, is your light shining?
Is your light shining?
Okay. Y'all know, are familiar with the book, Treasure Island?
Yes.
A guy named Robert Louis Stevenson wrote the book, Treasure Island. It's a kid's story and everything. And in his lifetime, in his childhood, he was a very sickly child. And he was bedridden for a lot of his youth, and one night his nurse found him with his nose pressed to the window looking outside. And why I share it with you is because back in the old days, they had furnaces and every room didn't get heated and everything. And he was a sickly child and it was cold and he had his nose up against the window looking out. And when his nurse saw him, she told him, get back in bed! You'll catch your death. What is it to say? You'll catch your death by silent. Boy, there's a lot of stuff we took for granted. But we heard it. But anyway, she said, you'll get sick and die. lamplighter. Now, in the old days, they didn't have street lamps. They had gas or kerosene lamps, and they had a guy who would go up from the ladder to each light, and he would light the light, and the fuel would, and he'd go to the next one. And he said to look, he said, there's a lamplighter. This is what he said, punching the holes in the dark. Punching holes in the dark. Now, why did I gravitate to that? Because Jesus says you are light. And part of your responsibility in a dark world is to punch holes in the dark.
All right.
Amen.
Can y'all look at me? There are situations and circumstances and places in your life where there's darkness. You have to be the light. The word of God says you are. He didn't say you ought to be. He says you are. So that's your job. Even on your job. As ungodly as the situation may be, you are to punch a hole in that darkness.
Amen. Amen.
What that means is that if work starts at 7:30, you don't show up at 7:30. Or 7:29. You get there at 7:15. And you know, that's how to make other folk a long time look bad.
Yeah.
And make you look good. See, the lips are like, uh-oh. Show up at 7:15. Be on the job. Don't quit working before lunch. You know, I gotta take 15, 20 before lunch and ready to lunch. Don't be on the internet looking at what you're going to buy when you're on that dime and that time. And I've heard people say, well, they allow us. I don't care what they allow you to do. They didn't hire you to serve, they hired you to work. We say as Christians, we do it as unto the Lord, and yet we do it as unto ourselves. But also means ink pens don't walk out the door.
All right.
Or paper, because what I'm doing for the job. Okay, I shouldn't have been like that. But it's your responsibility to hold in the spiritual darkness of a sin-sick world. Listen, folks, you cannot refuse to shine. You don't have that option. This little light of mine, I'm going to make it shine. That's not your option. You must dispel the darkness. That's your GMP. If it's dark when you show up, the light ought to overcome the dark. I don't care what it is. Tell your neighbor, it's your job. Now check this. When light hits an object, two things happen. It is either absorbed or reflected. When light hits an object, it's either absorbed or reflected. One or two. Now, either one of those options says something powerful about you. What that means is, when there's darkness around, the Bible's about science says that nature abhors a vacuum. So you have energy that emanates and radiates from you. And so you have the possibility of being able to connect and feel your presence. The power and the presence of God is absorbed by those around. Now, they might not understand, just like you didn't understand. But what needs to happen is there needs to be a planting. And what you plant is your spirit. You know, God's spirit in you. Change that. Because part of the problem is some of us plant our spirit, and that's what we get back. But we plant that as if it's absorbed. And the other thing, as I said, that light reflects. I go in a situation, and the light comes, and it hits her, and it reflects back because she's got light in her. And it's a way for me to be able to be connected and know I'm not by myself or alone on the journey. Let me help you in the natural realm. You familiar with photosynthesis? It hits the plant. The plant utilizes it, absorbs it, and what does it do? Sometimes you've got to be around a situation long enough to know that it might not change right away, but if you stay faithful to who God has made you to be, if you stay faithful in your attitude, if you be the right attitude, you'll see it takes a moment. How many of y'all have gardens or plant flowers or anything? Anybody been here? Okay. Now, when you drop the seed, you don't expect it to pop. The Bible says that the seed has to die in the ground. And it dies when it releases. What I'm saying to you is sometimes you plant the seed in the person and you've got to give them time. Amen. To allow the seed to both die in them and begin to, ready for this, your light continue to shine. It gives it what it needs so photosynthesis can happen and that thing began to finally blossom. The bloom and blossom. So we can't expect instantaneous results. You've got to continue to let your light shine. Are you ready for this? Okay. Light is either what? That's why light conquers darkness. Light also covers drabness. See this beautiful gown that this precious young lady is wearing? It's radiating from the light spectrum, blue and gold. If it weren't no light, you wouldn't see at all. It would be drab. Because one of the things that when light hits something and is totally absorbed, we see it as what?
Black.
When it's not absorbed, what color we see? White. That's a teacher for you. Now, we're not in high school, the preacher had flipped. That's what we see. So what happens is your light can bring a brightness into other people so that instead of seeing what you might see in the natural realm, God is allowing you to see the beauty of what he sees in the spirit realm.
Amen. Yes, Lord. Yes.
So that the world is attractive. Check this out. One of the reasons that we hang around or like other folk is because they bring something positive to us. Now, here's a sad commentary on that. As born again children of God, we ought to have the joy of Jesus no matter what situation we are in. We ought to know in our head, in our heart, in our mind, and in reality that there's nothing that can take us out. So therefore, I don't care what power, I don't care what person, I don't care what position strives to take you out or make you null and void, you know that you've already overcome that situation. So your spirit ought to be the right spirit in a wrong situation. You ought to have people come to you and say, listen, this job is the pits. I can't stand it. How do you maintain your smile? How do you maintain your joy? How do you maintain your spirit? And what you say to them, if it had not been for the Lord on my side, I couldn't handle this. So that's why God blesses you to be more than a conqueror. That becomes a witness. You become a testimony in that situation. So it colors and it changes deadness. Matter of fact, Jesus said that the light that you are is so powerful. Look at the next verse. He says your light is like a city set on a hill. See, that's powerful. That's powerful. He's saying you're like a city set on a hill that can be observed from a long distance. Back in Jesus' day, the cities were basically made of limestone. And when the lights were shining, you could see it from a distance. And what Jesus was saying to them, and he's saying to us, that even far away, when people are living in darkness, they ought to see. You ever go on the interstate, and you're out in the country someplace, and you're driving, and you finally get to a hill where you know this, in the distance, a bright light on the horizon, and you know you're finally getting to the place that you're trying to go. It may be Chicago, maybe, but the city, you can see the light from a far distance. And what happens is light draws us, light beckons. That's how you're gonna be. No, that's how you are. You're that kind of light. Own it. Possess it. Believe it. Wear it. Take your own light source into dark situations. Right now, we're struggling. For the last 3 weeks, stuff has been stupid. Crazy. Folk don't know which way to go. I talked to a young lady the other day, and she told me, she said, you know what? She said, I'm seriously thinking, she's got a number of years, she said, I'm seriously thinking about getting out the military. Now, somebody, she said, because they got an offer, I don't know what's going to happen, I'm scared. Thinking about bailing out, he may get us into a war. Forget the fact that we're already in a war. Right. But that became a fear. And I had to share with her, and I would share with you the same thing. What happens down there has no road to bearing on anything in your life. Quit getting caught up in the drum. Don't allow the distractions to mess with you. God placed in the position the person he has for the season, and then he sends us the word, if my people who are called by my name. You don't know the rest of the equation. 2 Chronicles 7, 14 will tell you. He says, I'll hear from heaven. I'll hear from him. So what we have to do is be smart enough and wise enough and bold enough to let our light shine and not worry about the moths circling around.
Amen.
I like that analogy. The reason I like it, I didn't have it on paper. The reason I like that analogy is because moths will circle around, and what happens when they get too close to the light? Come on, somebody. All right, let me finish this up. The city set on the hill, right? That's who you are, that's what you are. And here's the thing, that's government. The city is government. It's institutions. So Jesus let you know that you have power over governments and institutions. Can I just say something to y'all right now? See, we may remember, all we want to remember the results of what happened in the election, but do you know it was the lowest turnout in a presidential election in years?
Yeah.
And a whole lot of folk are complaining now, didn't vote. You have the ability to affect what happens whenever we decide to be bold enough to do the right thing. If you have problems, then instead of just talking and affecting and living, okay, I know I'm sorry. If your friends and family didn't vote, have problems, instead of letting them affect that lips, you should tell them how to vote. If you don't vote, you have no reason to do that. You have the power. We have the power to influence and make things happen. Why? Because you're light. If a so-called Christian in America would realize the potential that we have to be able to be influence in the world, influence in the nations, we can change not only America, we can change this entire world. But we're too willing to go along with garbage and stuff. So a city set on the hill, that's government, that's institutions. But then he also says a candle, that's the power of the individual. See, collectively we're the city, individually we're the candle. Just like Robert Louis Stevenson, talking about punching out the darkness, what I'm saying to you as a candle is this. When you leave this place, you will leave and you'll go into the dead, dark, deceived, and doomed world. That's real. But you have to understand in the verse 15 and verse 16. Verse 15 says, neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on the candlestick that it gives light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven. What he's saying, that as a candle, you have to go and be a witness.
Amen.
And what do you witness? You have to be a witness for God, for the Lord. That's your job. And here's what I want you to understand. Jesus doesn't challenge you to be a light. He says you are the light. Tell your neighbor you're a light. No, tell them with attitude. There's some folks sitting up and sitting next to you, and go tell that person sitting by themselves, you're a light. Jesus says, he says, you don't take a light and put it under a bushel. What he's saying is, quit throwing shade on the light. Told y'all that last week. Quit throwing shade on your light and quit throwing shade on other folks' light. First of all, who would light a candle and put it under a bushel? Why do you light the light in the first place? See. The minister Chandler says, because everyone needs a light. I like that too. So, when you take a bushel and put it over the light, what's going to happen? One of two things. I like the burning part. There's another Bible verse that says this, and this really blew my mind. He says, neither do men take a candle, not this one, I think Mark says, and put it under a bed. Now, I didn't realize something until we went to the Middle East, we went to Israel. When you see the houses, they don't have beds, y'all. They don't have beds. What they do at night is they roll out a mat and they sleep on the floor. So how do you put something under something that ain't even there? See, that's the power. He wants you to understand that light is meant to shine. are meant to shine.
Yes.
You speak this talking. One of the things that you said was on the air, I would say that always shoot for the moon. And even if you miss the moon, you'll be out there among the stars. And that's what God has created you to be, a bright, shining star in the universe. Now, do not forget what a star is. What is a star, y'all? It's a ball of fire at a great distance. So you've been made to be that star, to be that light that brings men and women into a relationship, and the purpose that you have is that you are the light, and you're either fulfilling it or you're failing at it. That's the only options. You're either fulfilling it or you're failing. Your purpose is to illuminate and expose. Can't be hidden under basketball. Can't be hidden under basket. Told you last week, Jesus says, you're light. You're light, and 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 you're light. He compliments us by giving to us the very title that he claimed. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Just thought around that for just a moment. He's saying to you, maybe no one's ever really affirmed you, but Jesus is affirming you now, and he says, you're just like me. I'm giving you a title that I gave myself. Come on now. We live for titles. Hold on to the military. We live for the title of the next rank so we could be called somebody. We live for titles. We go to educational institutions and look for the alphabet to be behind our name. We live for titles. We become parents so we can be called mom, dad. We live for titles. Super, we live for titles. And yet, no matter what title we get, it only takes you to the grave.
Yes, come on.
Amen.
So, you get in the grave, all that stuff is left behind. But he gives us a title that takes us to the grave and through the grave to life everlasting. Amen. He gives us a name that is above every other name. Listen, folks. Our mandate is to witness to the lost. And the power of your witness is your swag. See, about some of the respond to that. Why is the power of witness your swag? Because you can tell somebody that I've been through some stuff.
Yeah.
Been where you've been. And baby, look at me now. I'm walking, and I'm talking, I'm singing, and I'm praising my Lord. You hear what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And you can do it with some authority, with some pizzazz.
Yeah.
You can sing, what a mighty God I serve. Angels bow before him. Heaven and earth, what a mighty, you can swear. Look, can I tell you about a battle I was in? How the Lord stopped by and rested. I was in a fiery furnace. And I looked up and saw Jesus. And he didn't air condition the flame, but it was there so that power of your witness is your swag. It's your flow. It's your ability to operate in heavy fog. You have individual power. are. You are. I are what? You are. You are what? What God says I am. What God decrees and declares I am. See, some of us still play back those old tapes of folk calling us names. Some of us still think with that old little not me, chubby, whatever the case might be, slew-footed, pig-headed, or whatever, you know, all the names and stuff. We still think we trying to get forward. We think we overcome it. We haven't overcome it, because we still think we are it. Because I told my wife the other day, I was 40, probably 41 years old. And I've shared with you some of my own life story about being called names by my own family, my siblings, being laughed at, and sometimes even my mom and father, but that's another story. And it took me a long time to overcome my own self-image. I looked at myself and didn't think I was worth anything, didn't think very anybody really were running around and everything, and I believed that. And I was trying to fight through it. And can I tell you something honestly, just being candid and real? One of the reasons why I developed a sense of humor is because I realized when people are laughing with you, they wouldn't laugh at you. There's a lot of folk who use humor as a way to keep people away from them so that they don't really know sometimes how broken we can be and how devastated inwardly we are. And so we become the jokester. We become the funny-looking clown who's got a smile on the outside but his heart breaking on the inside, and I was one of those people. And I'd gone to some counseling, and I finally thought I had myself together. I was about 41 years old, and I was dating this woman who was kind of attractive, and we were out walking one day and running and everything, and she was telling me how beautiful she was, and she really was, and she said, "You're ugly." I was 21 years old. I thought I had life together. Long past that, but 41 years of age, and she said it in a place that made me so fragile that I broke down and cried. Turned around and walked away. I thought I'd gotten beyond that. But some of us still live with that stuff. And I'm here today to tell you that Jesus says some powerful things about who we are.
Amen.
What we've got to do is we've got to start believing that and rehearsing that and living in that so that we recognize how powerful we really are. You are what God says you are. You're His child. You're a holy nation, a peculiar people, the king for royalty. I just said royalties, but royalty, not royalties. That's two different things. That's who we are. And Jesus says that our life and our you are is your testimony. He's spoken to you your testimony. And my question in closing is, are you the light that Jesus wants you to be?
Amen.
Are you the place you're supposed to be? Because Jesus said it's so. And if you don't live it, what you're doing is you're calling God a lie. You're calling His word a lie. Your light, your salt, you're above and beyond, you're over, you're more than, you're healed, you're delivered. So, when I was a little kid, they still had, at least my grandparents and grandparents, they had kerosene lanterns. I don't know if you remember kerosene lanterns. But when they would light them, they give out bright light. But one of the things about kerosene, it was a dirty fuel. But what happened is, while it was burning, it also put a lot of soot out. And eventually the globe would get covered with soot, and you wouldn't see the light as bright as you could see it. But if you just took it off and cleaned it and put it back on, the light would be bright again. Maybe someone's here today and you need cleaned. Because your light is still burning, but it might not be as bright as it should be. God's word is here today to clean you up, to let you see clearly what God has destined for you. You are your son, you seasoned and enriched this world that we're living in.